So now the German nationalists, coordinating closely with Henry Carey and his circle, and when we got a new pope in the Catholic Church, Leo XIII, fundamentally reshaped German national policy. And they adopted a high tariff to replace free trade. They had the government in this new policy supervised huge industrial and technological development program. They dropped the anti-Catholic policy. And they adopted a protection for workers, that is, various forms of social security. This is back in the 1870s and 80s. And Germany joined the United States as the motor of world development. Now, what we want to do here is look behind this kind of thing, because we get some insights into how things work in the world. Germany today is stuck with the Maastricht system and so forth, stuck in depression. In late 1875, Chancellor Bismarck met with an industrialist named Kardorff, Wilhelm von Kardorff, completely unheard of today. He's the head of a small pro-Carey party in Germany who was spreading Henry Carey's works there. And Bismarck gave the green light to this guy to go ahead and organize industrialists and other people and farmers to push for a nationalist program. And we have in the archives up in Pennsylvania letters from these people inside politics in Germany to Henry Carey describing how this works. And Kardorff used this pamphlet, translated it, and got it all around. The attack on the British dope pushing in China, British free trade. And it was this American initiative that flipped the German policy and made Germany a great power. What was the American initiative? When America's nationalists alerted and were allowed to alert the leaders in other countries, in Germany, of the danger of the British Empire, that's what sent Germany into its final great leap to be a modern industrial power. They set up high protective duties. 1879, they passed high tariffs. Smelting and machine work increased 30%. Unemployment went up 40%. Wages increased. The government sponsored cartels of different companies to join together to pool laboratories. They set up banks whose only purpose was to build industry, not speculation, not usury. This is part of a completely government-guided system, but it's not communism. The idea was we're going to deliberately develop. And meanwhile, and they built canals, railroads, and so forth. And meanwhile, the United States, Americans, very idealistic Americans and Germans, joined together in a crash program to bring electricity to the world. That was part of this program, this political program. That's how the world got electricity. Next. We had in 1876 the 100th anniversary of the American Revolution, the Declaration of Independence. And we celebrated that by staging the most important world fair that's ever happened. It was a political event of highest consequence. It was organized by Henry Carey and his circle. Why'd they hold it in Philadelphia? Well, that was the capital of the revolution, right? And it still was. And the government of the United States made this our national celebration. This had a profound impact on Germany as well as the rest of the world. This centennial celebration, this World Fair, celebrated man's freedom in an absolute connection to industrial development, that is, technological power, national power, increased power over nature, absolutely inseparable from human freedom. And the Free Trade Party, the Gingrich Party of that day, tried to stop the fair. Senator Sumner in Massachusetts cut off the funding for it, declared that President Grant was overstepping his bounds to invite foreign nations to the celebration of America's centennial. He died, though, and they got away with it. All right, so next. What you saw previously was the, I'm sorry, put the other one back on. This is 100,000 people gathered in front of the memorial building, which was built for this, for the opening celebration. They're holding umbrellas, but the clouds lifted just at the time that it started. Next. This is inside the main building. You see some of these illustrations in our EIR issue. There's a band playing in the middle, some German products back there, and up at the upper left, hanging from the ceiling, is a very curious display that illustrates the principle of the land bridge. Next. This is what it is. It shows a kind of an air car. On one end is Confucius, and on the other end is Muhammad. And we are going to link the world. Next. This is a statue of the freed slave. And the idea here was that the United States had just come through successfully the Civil War, and the rest of the world had an increased admiration for the United States because we had abolished slavery. And because we had, in that struggle, which included 200,000 black soldiers, we had developed the most powerful military machine in the world. Next. You've all seen this thing. This is the arm of the Statue of Liberty. The Statue of Liberty was built for this centennial fair, but it never got set up until some years later in New York Harbor. It was delivered from France. This was the celebration of human freedom on this planet. Next. This is an I.P. Morris blast engine, one of hundreds and thousands of displays like this. It was for making steel. This blast engine delivered 170 cubic feet of air per second to a steelmaking operation. Next. Here we see principally Baldwin locomotives. One of these is on display. It's a beautiful machine down at the Smithsonian Institution in the, I think it's the Museum of American History, right next to the castle, so-called, on the Mall. Built for this centennial, because it's a political deal. They built those locomotives for political reasons. They wanted to display them to the world. They weren't just selling them. In the distance there, you can see the Corliss engine, whose steam devices were in another building, so it was totally silent here. But this turned all machinery in the fair. And this is the world's largest engine at the time. And they turned it on and off so people could see the power over nature that was being exhibited. Next. Here are the Japanese putting up their part, their building in the fair. And they had some racist attitudes on the part of spectators when they started this, because they're using some methods that are less than the highest level of machinery or something to put it up. But when they saw the quality of the workmanship and design of this building, they had tremendous admiration. And they were very, very popular there. Next. This is a Baldwin locomotive on display in Osaka, Japan. Many years later, we continued to pour out these locomotives for the development of these countries. Now, the head of the German delegation to this centennial was a man named Franz Rouleau, who's a professor of machine building and its principles. And he came to Philadelphia and spent several months conferring with the Carey people and the industrial and political leaders there. He became world famous by writing a sharp attack on Germany's industrial backwardness, Germany's subservience to British free trade policies, and its reputation for producing cheap and therefore bad products. This is a German professor, the head of their delegation. He wrote a book called Letters from Philadelphia, first serialized in papers attacking the petty chauvinism in Germany under this free trade and oligarch policy, and stupid militarism, which doesn't equal military power. He was a professor of machine building who introduced his students to Schiller's universal history teaching to teach them about machines. So he said that America produced excellent machines because its workers were very highly paid, intelligent and motivated, and because America had a protective tariff. Now, Adolf Hitler had a response to this. In 1940, just after Hitler launched the invasion of Russia, Hitler commented, "We were busy as bees." Now, this is an Austrian hippie, so he's saying we Germans, right? "We were busy as bees. We were able to mass produce goods. They were cheap, but at first they couldn't have the quality of the English product. We were beginners and didn't know the secrets of production. That's how, at a World's Fair in Philadelphia, German production got the attribute cheap and bad." But then three industries were developed. He names it to three different industries, in which our work was superior to the English in quality: chemical, electrical, and optical. Well, that's ironic, because how did Germany develop their industrial power? Not with slave labor like Hitler had, not a cheap chauvinist like Hitler, but by developing under a nationalist idea which celebrated man's freedom, as opposed to free trade. So the British say you can be for free trade or you can be for authoritarian dictatorship. Those are your two choices, communism or fascism, or free trade. That's all there is. No, nationalism built the world, and it was an idealistic nationalism that was the only practical step for mankind, only practical thing. Everything else failed. Total idealism was the only practical thing. Next. This was the exhibit at the Centennial of Russia. And we see there some of their machines. And there's a sign there that says the Practical Technological Institute of St. Petersburg. Another sign says the Imperial Technical School. They were showing off the beginnings of their industrial development at that time. Next. This is an advertising poster. If you can read Russian, the big word up at the top says Baldwin. This is an ad circulated throughout Russia around 1880 for the development, for the railroad, for the Baldwin Company. Next. This is the Hawaii section at the fair. Hawaii was an independent country at that time. And the head of the delegation from Hawaii was a missionary originally from America named Samuel Damon, who will later play a role in the Chinese Revolution that set up the present Chinese nation. This guy, Damon, wrote that racial harmony would prevail in Hawaii if we continue to treat man as man, irrespective of color or race. But a war will come, he's writing this just before the American Civil War, a war will come when the wicked doctrines of the London Times are allowed to prevail, and the Anglo-Saxon is allowed to displace an allegedly inferior race in the interests of trade and civilization. So he is the head of this Hawaiian delegation. He educated a Japanese youth named Manjiro, who was the first Japanese English speaker and translated for the U.S. Naval Expedition in 1850. Next. At the moment the Centennial Exposition opened in May of 1876, a young inventor named Thomas Alva Edison moved into this invention factory that was set up by the Carey people who backed him. He was their, in a sense, their employee. They sponsored him, financed him, protected him. This is at Menlo Park, New Jersey. Now, Edison was a very young inventor, and he displayed his telegraph, his first inventions, at this Centennial Exposition. Next. A couple of years later, You see the guy on the left? That's Professor George Barker, the head of Franklin Institute Research. And over there on the right, the last guy you can actually see with a sort of a scowl on his face is the young Thomas Edison. They're out on an astronomical trip out west in America. And it was there that the Carey and Bass people in the Philadelphia crowd, through Professor Barker, asked Thomas Edison to invent the electric light and develop electric power for the public, and challenged him to do that, and then helped him to do that. He soon had a press conference and announced that he was going to electrify the world. So at this meeting, at the centennial, a German named Emil Rathenau, came to the centennial. And a few years later, Rathenau and Thomas Edison set up a partnership. Rathenau founded the Edison Electric Company in Germany as a partner of Edison and these Carey people. And between them, they electrified, that is, Edison and Rathenau brought electricity to Austria, Switzerland, Italy, France, Belgium, Spain, Romania, Bulgaria, Russia, Poland, Denmark, Norway, Sweden, South Africa, Mexico, Brazil, Chile, Argentina, Japan, and China, and the United States. They made Berlin the capital of the Russian electrical industry. Berlin is not in Russia. Meanwhile, another partner of Edison, Frank Sprague, set up, and first partner of these Philadelphia guys, introduced electric streetcars and subway trains to the United States. All right, now, next. Another person you never heard of, Wharton Barker. He was a central figure in the project from here on out. This is a Carey insider in Philadelphia. It was at his house that the dignitaries from these other countries met when they came to the centennial. And just like they might come into Leesburg today, all right, to talk about what they're going to do. In 1878, he was hired by the Russian Tsar to build ships for the Russian Navy in the Philadelphia shipyard, warships. He then went to South Russia to supervise the industrialization of South Russia, or to plan that, with Bethlehem Steel, which was owned by his uncle, Joseph Wharton. And he also supervised the Ireland Revolution unit of the Carey people. That is, Irish people in America and Ireland, working together with this little circle of people, set up something called the Clan na Gael. And one of their central people went from Philadelphia to Ireland in 1878 and organized 20,000 feuding Irishmen into a central revolutionary organization called the Irish Revolutionary Brotherhood. And together with their Clan na Gael in the United States, which shipped arms and money to Ireland, that continued to be the main organization of Irish nationalism until Michael Collins and Arthur Griffith, who worked for that organization, established the nation of Ireland right after World War I. The plan was that the United States, Russia, together would make war on England and there'd be an Irish uprising. That was what these guys were organizing for. Unfortunately, Alexander II and his candidate for president that he put in the White House, Garfield, both were assassinated within a few months of each other. Next. Now, you don't have to read this, but I just put it up there. There was a fellow named Terence Powderly who was part of this little inner circle in Philadelphia. He's well known historically as the head of the first mass organization of working people called the Knights of Labor. And under his leadership, they increased it from a little secret society to 800,000 members, black and white, women and men, immigrants and long-term Americans, and employed and unemployed. Purpose was to study political economy and to defend the rights of workers against employers that were mindlessly attacking workers. That's how he's known. He's the most famous labor leader in that whole era. He introduced as a leader of labor, the concept of a mass organization of workers, not socialists. He was a Careyite. He's part of this inner circle, and he was the treasurer of the skirmish fund that sent the guns over to Ireland for this Carey organization. Now, he's not known for his political activity in this circle of American nationalists. Here's a letter from Terence Powderly to Wharton Barker, a banker in Philadelphia. And they are conniving in the development of American politics. The British didn't like this. And they got the Canadian Catholic Church to try to tell the Pope, don't allow this. Because these guys were organizing workers in Canada and Britain and all over the world while they were doing all these other initiatives. Next. But the new Pope, Leo XIII, was on their side, and he was working in tandem with Carey and the American Nationalists. And so this is a British cartoon in the magazine Puck attacking the Knights of Labor and attacking the Cardinal of the Catholic Church, Gibbons, that was an ally of the Knights of Labor and had worked with the Pope to help get Vatican protection for this operation. And so this is a British cartoon saying, look at these scandalous, ugly workers, these ignorant workers attacking this poor fellow, this poor scab, who doesn't want to be in their union. And the Catholics should be ashamed of themselves for participating in this. Next. And here the British portray Pope Leo XIII as a lunatic who is supporting Irish Revolution and worker uprising because he was on the same side as these American nationalists. And it was because of this combination, really, that Germany got this social security system of health insurance and so forth for the workers in the 1880s. Next. Here is a map of the Trans-Siberian Railway built by the Russians in the 1890s, finally, under the Prime Minister of Russia at that time, Count Witte, who was later Prime Minister. He was developing the policy of the American nationalists there. He was in favor of the American economic system. And the Baldwin Locomotive Company provided these locomotives, and Carnegie Steel provided the rails and so forth. This was a joint American and Russian product. Next, the American President McKinley was assassinated in 1901. That cut off, when Teddy Roosevelt came in, cut off American assistance to this type of project. When you put the British-loving faction in control of America. This is a Baldwin locomotive built for Russia in 1896. Next. This is a contract signed by Wharton Barker, or by his representative Eugene so-and-so, with the Chinese government in the 1880s to build railroads all over China, with the Chinese Empire, 1886. And this is in the Library of Congress, in the Wharton Barker papers. Next, the plans were to develop a national bank for China and to build railroads and telephone lines and modern industry throughout the country of China. And this is a map. You can just barely see on the screen the lines that Wharton Barker drew. This is in the files at the Library of Congress of the plans for this system, an American instituted massive development project in China. Next. EIR traced the lines that were projected by Barker, by the American nationalists, and they were going to hook up with the Russians. And what happened with this is that the British came down in a virtual military attack against this deal. And they circulated press lies. You might hear this today. China Gate today against our president, against the Chinese. Same thing. What did they say about this? They said that, first of all, there's no such contract. And when the Chinese said, yes, there is, and appeared in the press, they said, well, yes, there's a contract, but it's fraudulent. And then when they said, no, it's not fraudulent, they said they've canceled it. And they kept the pressure up, right? The same paper would say all those different things, right? British government finally exerted terrible pressure. They had the Navy, and they had a bad U.S. president at that time, Grover Cleveland. And the press was full of racist anti-Chinese silk, and they forced a cancellation of this finally. Barker tried again later, 1895. He was called by the Chinese viceroy there. They worked out another deal for $125 million program, 5,000 miles of railroad lines to develop a Navy, a merchant marine, steel mills, and locomotive plants. That was also shut down. That was stopped by the British. Next. This is Baldwin Locomotive Park. You can see some of the boilers there and things in the crates. Unloaded on the dock in China, in the port city of Nuchang, 1890. It's a photograph from the Railroad Gazette. Now, it didn't work out. China had a very weak, corrupt Manchu dynasty that fell under the complete domination of foreigners, particularly the British. Next. So at the same time, here's Hawaii, right? The Hawaiian delegation. What happened is, in Hawaii, these American nationalists had a last bastion of their influence, even while American government was becoming under the dominance of British policy. And they put together an organization in Hawaii led by one of their proteges and young friends named Sun-Yat Sen, whose organization was created in Hawaii at the house of the son of the guy who ran this thing. Frank Damon, whose father ran this. Frank Damon had been in Berlin as the Hawaiian embassy leader during the period when Carey was working over there. And he provided money and support and even military training to the beginning of Sun Yat-sen's organization in Hawaii. And Sun Yat-sen used it as a base back and forth from Hawaii to develop his revolutionary movement in China. He had the same goals as Carey and the same ideas as Lincoln of massive economic development in China and tremendous railroad and other infrastructure development. This infrastructure is what, this idea of the meaning of this kind of program is what FDR had. And his politics against Churchill is what was inherited by this new Chinese leadership that developed after America had kind of gone to sleep in the world. And so they have left this legacy to us now that we are now reviving in the world. Thank you.